too dull. Nothing is true anymore. What I've been through is much. Your heart can heal the pain.
Hey, good morning, church. Welcome, you guys. Would y'all go ahead and stand with me? We're so glad you guys are here as we continue in our series called Altars. And last week, Pastor Brad, he defined an altar as a place where man and God meet. And an altar is a place where man would bring a sacrifice. But listen to the sacrifice that we get to bring because of Jesus. Listen to Hebrews 13, verse 15. It says, through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that confess his name. It says, through Jesus, let us continually offer to God. We don't have to bring a sacrifice of atonement because Jesus has done that, but we get to bring a sacrifice of praise. And it says it's the fruit, the evidence of someone who confesses the name of Jesus. So as followers of Jesus, the evidence of that is to bring a sacrifice of praise. He has made a way. That's our reason to sing. It's our reason to clap. It's our reason to shout. So would you join me in bringing a sacrifice of praise to our God this morning?
perfect in every way. My one and only Savior, I live to bring you praise.
It's a song that is rising now, of a hope that is breaking out. I won't run, I won't back down. The whole world will hear me shout. Declares your glory, Lord, we give you praise.
No one beside you, for who is like the Lord Almighty. Oh, we give you praise, for you are holy. The universe declares your glory, Lord, we give you praise. No one beside you, for who is like the Lord.
Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle. morning, church. We are so excited to get to be able to do baptism again this week. We have two amazing stories. We have Tim and his daughter Alyssa that are going to be getting baptized here today. They both prayed to receive Christ last year, and we are so excited to be able to see them take their next steps. And what baptism is going public. It's a public profession of your faith, saying that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. So that now all of their family, the people here cheering them on, and all of our church family here, we all know how we can pray and we can help them move forward as they follow Christ. So I'm going to let Tim share a little bit of his story.
Thank you, Chris. As challenging as 2020 was in many ways, it was an amazing year for me in the most important way. I started coming to NewSpring Church last year with my fiance, and found God through the church. God filled a void in my heart that had been here for many years, and I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I'm so happy to... Thank you. So happy to be going through this process to show my commitment to the Lord, and so very... very special to do this with my daughter, Alyssa, today. I'm so very proud of you, and I love you, Alyssa.
Awesome. So with that profession of faith, Tim, I want to ask you, who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ.
It is now based on your profession that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So this is Alyssa, and she's going to share her story.
Okay, I was in high school when I decided I wanted to dedicate my life to God. Since that day, I waited for the moment that I would feel ready to become baptized. I'm a freshman in college now, and I've become very close with God over these past few months. I was at my lowest point when I turned to Him, and He quickly changed my life for the better. I realize now that I want to serve God and spread His word for the rest of my life.
Awesome. Alyssa, who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ.
It is now based on your profession of your faith in Jesus Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Celebrating, church. Let's sing. You're the Father of creation.
You're the Father of creation, who fashions from the dust. You're speaking into chaos, restoring what was lost. Fear not. Thank you.
Oh, come on, he's worthy and he's holy, isn't he, church? Yes, he is. Bless the Lord. Hey, we're live on all 14 campuses right now, and I want to give you a reason to celebrate while you're still on your feet. I hope you're ready to bless the name of the Lord. But this weekend is NewSpring Church's 21st birthday. Can we thank the Lord for his faithfulness to us as a church? Man, he's seen us through some incredible days, and we're just getting started, and it's at a great, great time. So, hey, why don't you go ahead and take a seat? I'm going to give you some more things that are coming up for us while you're finding your seat. So good to see you. Well done. The great thing about these masks is it's keeping COVID down and it's keeping our nose warm on the walk in from the car this morning. So thank you for wearing your mask in the room, and we're grateful for that. I'm going to celebrate with you a couple of things. Number one thing I want to celebrate with you in addition to our birthday is that today in Greenville, South Carolina is their last load in, load out moment. They're excited. We got our certificate of occupancy for the new facility opening up on the 24th. And so Greenville, I know you've got a special day, but come on, Anderson, let's thank them. Thank the Lord for that and celebrate them. We love you guys. We're pumped for you guys. They get the chance today to celebrate with all of their former campus pastors are there today. So we've got Lee and David and Howard all the way back to the very beginning of that campus back in the early 2000s. So we're pumped, and I'm actually going to get off the stage here and run over there to celebrate with them in just a moment. We've also got men's events coming up. Fellas, I wanted you to know this, but we've creatively innovated a bit. We didn't want to cancel the event. We didn't want COVID cancellation to occur. And so what we're doing is, and you'll hear more about this from your campus pastor, instead of having it all in one place, we're going to break it out so it can be at your campus. And so your campus pastor or a pastor there will tell you more about the men's events to come. It's going to be special, special days. So when you hear more about that, make sure you sign up for that. And if you've got a son in your life or a husband in your life, I'm telling you, these are going to be special, special events. So make sure you're leaning into that. And then another thing as well, we've been in now day 7 of 21 days of prayer and fasting. How many of you came this week at 6 a.m. on a campus? How many of you came? I know the 11:15 crowd's like, we sleep in. Yeah, but we had hundreds of folks come this week, and we're gonna crank it up again tomorrow morning at 6 a.m. We literally have seen, I'll celebrate a campus. Powdersville's got more people coming this year to the 6 a.m. prayer than they did last year when there was no COVID. So well done, Powdersville. You guys are leading the way there. And we'll see you tomorrow morning on our day 8 as we start a brand new week. And it's a special and significant week. Tomorrow, our world will celebrate Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Tomorrow, our church will do the same. And I want to take a moment right here at the top of the day to tell you why that's such a big deal. You see, Dr. King was first and foremost a citizen of heaven. And I think he exemplifies in many ways something we all as Christians are aiming for. How do you live in a world that is full of all the things that the world is filled with and still find yourself being a kingdom of heaven first? And let me tell you one of the things that I see in Dr. King. I want to commend them to you. The reason that I get so inspired, many reasons, but the reason I get so inspired was he was a man who lived by word and deed. How many of y'all know there's a lot of people that are saying things, but their life doesn't look like what they're saying? Can we get an amen on that? You know, they can say it, but their life is hypocritical in that regard. Well, Dr. King, he said things like this quote that'll be on the screen. You'll probably see it tomorrow. You know, people will talk about this reality that he reminds us that darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. And hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. That's such a really salient way to say it. You know why it's so clear and salient? Because it comes from our Lord and Savior's mouth. John 1, Jesus is described as being light. And the darkness tries to hide it, but it can't. Light wins every single time. And Dr. King would take these timeless truths of Scripture and deliver them in a timely manner. But he wouldn't just use his words. He would use his actions, his deeds. You know, you're at NewSpring Church where we say all the time that our rally cry and our vision is we want to be a life-giving church, a life-giving people marked by the presence of God, activated to impact. We don't want to just do a Sunday morning kind of following Jesus. We want to do an everyday relationship with God. And Dr. King did that. One of the things that all kinds of people all around the world, not Christians, look in and commend him for was he was committed to really ushering in change, but doing it based on the principles that he found in Jesus in a non-violent manner. So he would live with word and with deed. He would train people to be ready to take a slap in the face, be ready for people to spit on you, be ready for people to come at you and persecute you for what you believe, but be ready to respond like Jesus with non-violence. Can't you just see Jesus in the garden when Peter takes out the sword and cuts off the ear of the person coming to arrest him? And Jesus says, no, we're not going to advance my kingdom with swords like that. We're going to advance my kingdom with the word, the sword of the Spirit. And Dr. King did such a good job of that. So let me give you this this helpful tool. Maybe this will be something to inspire you. Maybe you know more or less about Dr. King, and we wanted to help put some things in front of you that I think will encourage you as a follower of Jesus. If you will, and I want to really challenge you, would you take your phone out and text MLK to 30303? We've put together some incredible resources. I'm talking inspiring Jesus kingdom building resources that are going to allow you to have conversations, that are going to allow you to celebrate. And really, this week, we're going to be praying towards this at 6 a.m. Part of tomorrow is praying towards reconciliation. And this is a truth. Everybody recognizes this. Okay, listen, Barna polled churches, and every kind of Christian from every side of the aisle said that 95% of Christians believe that the church has a part, a major and significant part to play in racial reconciliation. 95%. And so the truth is, we just got to figure out how. And we are committed to pursuing common unity in this house. And so join us tomorrow as we pray towards this. I hope you'll make it a priority. I'd love tomorrow to be the largest day of participation between 6 and 7 a.m. that we've seen. So I just want to encourage you to get out of bed and come and join us. And you can, if you can't make it because you've got something going on, you can watch online. That, of course, will be online as well. And today, we're continuing now in this same level of activation in our altars series. Last week, we talked about the altar of the heart. Meredith is coming out here in just a moment to talk to us about the altar of the home. And I'll tell you this, this is one of the finest, encouraging, convicting messages that I have ever, ever, ever heard in my life. Okay, I'm not speaking in hyperbole here. This is a great message. So I want to pray for us as we lean into these days in this moment. And church, I want to tell you, you're doing a great job. Let's keep bringing that light because the darkness can't hide from the light. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, thank you. Thank you for this word you're about to share with us, God, from your word. Thank you for the truth of the altar of the home. And Lord, I pray that you would encourage us as we receive and encourage Meredith as she brings this great teaching to us that comes straight from your heart. We ask that you, Jesus, would be glorified in it all. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Y'all welcome Meredith.
Come on now, church family. Hey, everybody across the state. Just want to say I'm so excited to be with you this morning. And I just off the back of what Brad just said, I'm in a group text. Caleb White is in there, our fuse director. And he said in that group text this week, man, I love who our church is becoming. And let me just testify and add my amen to him that I love who our church is becoming as we learn together how to pursue uncommon unity. And hey, as we turn 21 years old. Because listen, y'all know when you turn 21, it comes with some added weight, added responsibility, and I'm believing for our church, added authority as we move into our 21st year, that God is pouring more on us to accomplish as a church than we did in the first 21. Come on now. So listen, we're going to jump straight in today. I ain't got time to waste, and the word is too good to waste any time. So we're going to jump right in and start talking about revival. Is that okay with everybody? Can we start with talking about, hey, you came to church, you're tuning in online, let's jump right in and discuss revival. Okay, so who at NewSpring would say, I want revival? Amen, yes, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Revival, Lord, let it come. You know, we have these songs about revival, God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. If you grew up Pentecostal like me, you went to those tent revivals. But again, if you're also from my generation, it was less of the God of revival poured out and more of the Kirk Franklin. Anybody? Do you want a revolution? Hey, we got some saints in the house today. If you don't know what I'm talking about, get on YouTube, Apple Music, whatever, you know, supplier you use. Kirk Franklin, do you want a revolution? Ooh, ooh, that's what it went. And as a like sixth grader, I'm like, ooh, ooh. And I have no idea what revolution means, but I'm in because the song just goes there. So we say we want a revolution, we want revival, we pray for it. Even in 21 days of prayer, we're gonna believe for it. But the question is, what is it? If we say we want it, we say we believe for it, we pray for it. Kirk Franklin is singing about it, we're singing songs about it. What is it? And here's what I believe firmly. You can start by writing this down today. Revival is a community consumed by the presence of God. Revival is a community consumed by the presence of God. And when we are consumed by the presence of God, I mean absolutely saturated by it. It means that the desires of our heart begin to change. We want what God wants. We desire what God wants. And so it no longer means that we just pray, Lord, let your kingdom come, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It means that the kingdom cannot help but break out wherever we go, because that's what the presence of God does when it consumes a people. That's what we're praying for when we're praying for revival. We're saying, God, come and consume me and this entire community. So the question is, what does an altar have to do with that? What's an altar have to do with revival and be consumed? Well, Brad taught this last week. Hopefully you didn't miss it, but he said this: the altar is a place where God and man meet. The altar is the place where God and man meet. It's a place of presence. It's a place of sacrifice, of communion. It's a place of coming and being completely consumed, namely consumed with relationship. And we see this all throughout the Bible, right? Abraham constructs an altar and God meets him there. We see Elijah construct an altar and fire literally falls from heaven to consume the altar. We see the people of Israel that they had an altar at the place of meeting, and it says that the presence of God would come like a cloud and like fire. Over and over and over again, we see God is drawn to altars. People are called to altars. And when those two meet, revival breaks out. So why altars? Well, because the altar is where revival begins. If we say we want revival, if we pray for revival, we want to be consumed, then it starts at the altar. Which is why we wanted to spend the first 4 weeks of the year talking about the altar, setting the tone with altar. And last week, Brad did that by talking about the altar of the heart. And listen, I just want to unapologetically honor Brad Cooper for the unction and the passion that he brought last week with his message. Can we honor one of our pastors, Brad Cooper, together? Come on now. And let me just say this, that is not just something Brad Cooper does on stage. We have been in meetings and in places that'll never be on a stage, but where he is leading the way in that kind of posture. So we talked about the heart last week, and next week Dan's gonna come with a message of the altar of the church, and then we're gonna talk about the altar of the city. But today I get to talk about the altar that hits a little closer to home. That was a pun and a bad joke. But we're going to be talking about the altar of the home. So hey, I'm going straight teacher mode today. That's why I wore a blazer, and that's why I have a chalkboard. Because I believe if I'm going to teach with a chalkboard, then I just have to wear a blazer. And I hope my mom is watching right now. My mom is a fourth grade teacher, Susan Knox. She was my fourth grade teacher. That's right. I had to call her Mrs. Knox instead of mom. And if I called her mom, I got in trouble. But she is, I'm telling you, teachers, you are heroes and saints. And everything else that I can say, you deserve so much more money and so much more just honor due to you. So thank you, thank you, thank you for what you do. Mom, that was for you, but also every teacher here. So this is my teacher handwriting. I think it's pretty good. But I mean, I think we've all seen this verse before, right? If you've ever ventured into a Hobby Lobby, if you've ever had the boldness, then you've seen this scripture. Now listen, Hobby Lobby's great, no Hobby Lobby hate. But if you're going to Hobby Lobby, then you better be going when it's 50% off, unless you just got it different than I do, because if it's not 50% off, then your bank account's gonna be emptied out. But maybe you have this hanging in your home on the wall, and listen, I love this scripture too. But this scripture hanging on a wall and not defined in our hearts won't do anybody any good. Worse than that, this scripture hanging on a wall and us not defining it in our hearts might make us liars. And let me tell you, I don't want to be a liar, and I don't want anybody in my church house to be a liar. So we're going to come around the scripture today. What is going on here? What's the context of culture? What is happening around these words? Well, these words are said by Joshua, who became the leader of the Israelites after Moses had died. And he's coming and he's old now. So he was a young man when he was given leadership, but he's old now. And you can almost hear, if you go back and read Joshua 24, you can almost hear the dad desperation. Do you know what I mean? Like, he knows, I'm about to be gone, I'm about to be out. You have to get these words. He starts recounting everything that God had done. He's like, I was there, I helped lead you across to the promised land. He's like, I was there when the walls of Jericho came down. I was there when we chased out the giants of the land. I was there for the victories. You, I saw your family grow. I saw God's faithfulness, but I'm about to be gone. And I'm telling you, he's saying we have to get this here and now before I head out. So around that, he says this, that's the context, and he's saying, so my family has chosen, but today it's time for us to choose. So this is Joshua 24, starting in verse 15, and he says, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Then the people answered, well, far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods, for it is the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up from the land of Egypt out of the house of slavery and who did those great signs in our sight and preserved us in all the way that we went and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples and the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God. So the Israelites are like, yep, in. About it, about that life. They're like, not just you, Joshua, me and my house, we will serve the Lord, let's ride, we are about it, okay? So that's the exchange that happens here in Joshua 24, but then we see the flipping of one page and we get to Judges 2, verses 6 through 10. Look at this. So Joshua dismissed the people of Israel went each to his inheritance to take possession of the land, and the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great work that the Lord had done for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110 years. And they buried him within the boundaries of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres in the hill country of Ephraim, north of the mountain of Gash. And all that generation also gathered to their fathers. Look at this. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel. How do you go from, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, in one page, there arose a generation who did not know the Lord? We're in Joshua, we're about it. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And there arose another generation who did not know the Lord and the works that he had done. What happened in this page? This page, listen, that's how short of a time from the moment they made the promise to the moment that the generation right out of them walked away from the Lord. What happened in this razor's edge distance? Well, quite practically, a few things happened. They did begin to settle in the land that God had given them, which means they began to accumulate some possessions and some land. No longer was the temple or the place of meeting literally in the center of their camp like it used to be in the wilderness, where all of their homes would be pointed to the tent of meeting so they know who the center of their life was, who the center of their home was. No, now they were spread all throughout the country. No more miraculous provision of manna, no more reliance on miraculous quail, no more side by side. They were spread all throughout, and there started to be a gap of an altar in one page. So what we see here from Joshua 24 in this distance to Judges 2, is a gap of an altar. And this isn't a gap of an altar of the people themselves, of their heart, because they said, yeah, it says in scripture that they all served the Lord all the days of Joshua, even after he died. This isn't a gap of the church, because that kind of worship where they would come to the altar, that persists through generations. This isn't a gap of government. This isn't an altar gap of education. This right here, this gap of altar is a gap of an altar in the home. Apparently, someone didn't take personal action to invite the next generation to active participation in what it looks like for the entire life to be centered, for the home to be centered around the gospel. You know, maybe they saw their parents going to temple every day. Maybe their parents had a Yahweh bumper sticker on their donkey-drawn cart that was stuck on the back, you know? Maybe they saw the sacrifices that their parents gave, but apparently there's a disconnect between the religion that they saw at the temple and the religion that they saw at home. Are you hearing me, church? And what I do not want for us, for our generation, for New Spring Church, is for this gap to exist with us. Listen, I love Fuse. I love Rally. I love Kidspring. I hope I am that weird old lady at Fuse who just refuses to leave. That they're like, oh, crazy old mayor. And I'm like, that's right, I'm still here. I hope that I have Fuse groups until I'm 98. I hope that Rally exists forever. Kidspring is one of the greatest gifts, not to just this house, but to churches all across the nation and the world as thousands lean in to what our Kidspring team produces every week. But as much as I love Fuse, as much as I love Rally, as much as I love Kidspring, none of those can take the place of the personal altar that we are meant to build in our home. So single, married, married again, no kids, many kids, so many kids, you don't know where your kids are right now. Can we lean into this message together and say, I'm gonna commit that this gap doesn't happen in my generation, not on my watch and not in my house. This is up to us. So the question is, how do we do that? How do we make sure that doesn't happen? Hopefully everyone's feeling the sweet sting of conviction right now, but I don't want to just end there. How do we put this to action? Well, Joshua is such a good leader that he gives us that answer in a few verses just before he said the Hobby Lobby verse. He says this in Joshua 24, verses 14 through 15. He says, now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. And if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, then choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your fathers served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Here I think we see three ways that Joshua teaches us to build an altar in our home. So can I invite us 11:15 this morning to gather around the altar together and ask the Lord to consume us and give us a vision for how our home is meant to be placed on the altar. Can we do that together as we build an altar of our home? Just call me the Joanna Gaines of New Spring Church today as I tell us how to construct an altar. If you don't know who that is, ask your wife. So let's get into these three ways to construct an altar in the home today. Number one, choose the Lord every single day. Choose the Lord every single day. Now, Joshua ends here, but I'm gonna start here because I think first we have to opt in to this kind of life. We have to choose, not just at the moment of salvation, but every single day to give our yes to Jesus. You know how easy it is to say yes in a moment and then wake up tomorrow and be like, I don't feel like it. Maybe y'all are holier than me, but y'all know how we are. We drift. We're so passionate in a moment or in an altar call at church, but then every single day we have to pray, Jesus, you have my yes again. You have my obedience again. You have my submission again. Even today, if I don't feel like it, I remember the commitment I made and I give you my yes again. That's what it means to choose the Lord every single day. And you see, I don't think the Israelites were like purposefully lying when they told Joshua, yeah, as for us in our house, we'll serve the Lord too. I don't think they were, you know, intent on a malicious way to not come through. I just don't think they knew what they were saying yes to. So church, very directly today, can I ask you, do you know what you said yes to? Like for real? Now listen, not when it comes to salvation, because make no mistake, salvation, free. Jesus' blood, powerful enough, rich enough to purchase all of salvation. Jesus paid it all. I started too high and then was scared I wasn't gonna hit that note, but I did. We got there. Jesus paid it all is true. Salvation is free. But discipleship, that costs something. Actually following Jesus every single day, whoo, that costs something. If you want a challenge, you want to get a swift kick to the spirit, go buy The Cost of Discipleship by Dietrich Bonhoeffer. That's his name. And let it challenge you. Even in Luke 9:23, Jesus himself says this. Those who would come after me, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and daily follow me. I think we all know what a cross was used for. It was a marker of death. If you saw a man in those times walking down a street with a cross on their back, then you knew, whoo, that person's not coming back from wherever they're going. Here's the thing. When we received Jesus, church, then we said, wherever Jesus leads me, I'm not going back to where I came from. That I have decided, the scripture is very clear about this, that when we come in agreement with Jesus, that we're saying everything about my old life, my desires, my ways, my feelings, my opinions, they get crucified with Christ so that a new life can be raised up with him. If you feel like your life is lacking miracles, if you feel like it's just drenched in apathy, if you feel like anything about Christianity is getting boring, then maybe let me say you've answered the call to salvation, but not yet the call to come and die. This is what we said yes to. An altar needs something to burn, and a revival needs someone to consume. Let it be us. Lennon Ravenhill puts it this way. We must alter the altar, for the altar is a place to die on. Let those who will not pay this price leave it alone. Ooh, that's heavy. Nah, that's light and easy when you follow Jesus. Because you realize anything that you put on the altar to be sacrificed is actually an invitation to a miracle of resurrection. Can I get an amen this morning? So here's what I want to say about us as a church family. The church house is a reflection of every family house it represents. The church house is a reflection of every family house it represents. Our church can and only will look like the accumulative houses that are represented in the room. We cannot look different than the houses that are represented in our rooms. So let me put it this way. If you have ever said in your home or wherever, God, I just want worship at NewSpring to look like blank. Does it look like that in your house? Because if it doesn't look like that in your house, then it can't look like that in this house. Can I do a confession? Can we have confession time? Y'all can just, family? All right. You know I get frustrated with y'all. Families do that. You ever get frustrated with your brothers and sisters? Yeah. Many of you know I'm a worship leader as well, and sometimes I'll be leading worship up here, and I mean, I'm in it. I'm like, King of Kings, yes, Lord. I'm like there, and I look down, and I just see this. I'm like, I got something in my nose. And my flesh, confession, my flesh will go, what a heathen. Awkward laughs. It's okay. I'm about to get the confession part. You ever try to lead worship and the Holy Spirit just convicts the mess out of you while you're leading worship? And you should be like, I'll just put this microphone down and exit, you know, stage left. But my flesh has genuinely responded that way, and the Holy Spirit will go, I'm sorry. The way you are leading worship right now from the stage, have you been singing worship like that all week in your house? Or is this the first time you've lifted your hands this week? King of Kings. Yes, Lord. We will talk about this later. I cannot expect worship to look differently in here than it looks like with me every single day of the week. Maybe you said, I just want prayer in our church to look like this. Does it look like that in your house? How many hours are you spending on the floor? I just want our church to be consumed with the Word of God. How much Word of God are you consuming through the week? How much Word of God am I consuming throughout the week? Because let me tell you, is your religion making it from the church house to your house? Because I can promise whatever's happening at your house is making it to the church house, whether good or bad. And I am very aware of it, and I promise you, I am trying to go first with you. We got to choose the Lord every single day, not just when we are in here together on Sundays, Wednesdays, or any other day of the week. We got to choose the Lord. But number two, we got to take personal responsibility for how my home brings heaven to earth. Take personal responsibility for how my home brings heaven to earth. Five times in those two verses, Joshua urges the people to serve the Lord. Serve the Lord, serve the Lord, serve the Lord. Now, in the original Hebrew, that is the word avad. I sounded just like when you hit that play on Google, avad. That is how you say the original Hebrew word. And there's many different translations for it, but ultimately, overwhelmingly, it means to work, to labor, or to do work. Joshua is saying, hey, your home, my home, is personal evidence to the world that you have skin in the game. It is the reflection of God's kingdom to the world. Another way of saying that, and I believe this with everything in me, the home is the primary place of discipleship, evangelism, and pursuing uncommon unity. It's the primary place. Now listen, as a church, we are committed to those three things. We're asking for feedback on how we can get better on those three things. So many of you have challenged us on those three things, and I've seen our leadership on their face asking Holy Spirit, help us to get better at those three things. Our church is committed to it, but that's Dan's job to teach on the church next week. I gotta talk about the home. How are we in our homes doing those three things? So let's just walk through these three things together, all right? Let's talk discipleship. John Tyson says that there's what you wanna pass on and there's what you actually pass on. There's what you wanna pass on and what you actually pass on. So I'll just get personal, I'll talk about my house, the house I grew up in. Now, I'm the youngest of three. I have two older brothers, and I know what many of you are thinking. That probably means you were so spoiled. I'm like, you're right. Ain't no shame in my game. You know, was I daddy's girl? Yeah. Did I play that card? Sure. As a 33-year-old woman, do I still play that card? Maybe. It is what it is. But my dad had this phrase that he always said. He still says it to this day. Growing up, he would always go, Meredith, do you know who you are? You're my daughter. Always like that. You're my daughter. And as a kid, I was like, I know. Even this past Christmas, he'd be like, Meredith, do you know who you are? I'm like, Dad. He's like, do you know who you are? You're my daughter. I never knew why he said that. I thought it was just like a dad catchphrase. Like, you know, dads, you know you got a catchphrase. And this past Christmas, he finally said, do you know why I've always said that to you? I'm like, guess I never really thought about it. He said, I wanted my family to have to never question who they are. And let me just testify. This is a testimony to the Holy Spirit working through my dad. I have my own insecurities like everybody else, but can I just be really honest? I've never had any massive gaps in my identity. Why? Because my dad actively passed down what he actually wanted to pass down. And the church didn't pass that on to me. The government didn't pass that on to me. Education didn't pass that on to me. The sports I played at Washington High School or Anderson University didn't pass that on to me. That happened inside of my home where my mom and my dad were focused on my personal discipleship. That happens in our home. Let's talk about pursuing uncommon unity. I think we can all agree through, you know, recent history that unity is not just gonna happen as a result of our passivity. Listen, I want our nation to be united. I want our church to be diversified. But if we think that somebody else's platform is going to solve that for us, we may be waiting a very long time. My home is the place that I get to actively pursue uncommon unity and not have to wait for anybody else to solve it, because I know I can solve it around one table, my kitchen table. So I just wrote a list that I think, when I'm talking, what are you talking about? Here's what I'm talking about, the kind of people that we can invite in and gather around our table. I'm talking rich and poor, old and young, Democrat and Republican, black and white, Hispanic and Filipino, members of NewSpring and the church down the street, the educated and the ones who graduated from the streets, the religious and the rebel, the faith-filled and the barely hanging on, the single and the married, the ones with no kids and the ones with many, the Calvinist and the charismatic, the woke and the broke, the holy roller and the only slightly saved. Do you get my point? If there is no one sitting around our kitchen tables who disagree with us or who don't look like us, then why on God's green earth would we expect them to fill a church seat next to us? It starts in our home. Let me brag on two members of our church, High King and Kareem. They're two of my very good friends. And tomorrow, as you know, is Martin Luther King Jr. Day. And I've seen them do two things. One, press this church and have honest conversations about what it looks like to pursue uncommon unity. But two, pursue it in their homes. Tomorrow, Hiking put this thing out on Instagram that he said, hey, I wanna invite a COVID-friendly number of people over to my house to watch Selma, which is a story of a march that Martin Luther King Jr. led, to have pointed conversation around it and then to pray together for unity in our nation. That's what it looks like. But you know what's even more awesome? Somebody else caught wind that he didn't have enough room, so they said, I'll open my home to watch it, to have pointed conversation and then pray for it. A revival was lit in High King's house that caught fire in somebody else's house. Now they're both pursuing uncommon unity. That's how it works. And thirdly, evangelism, people actually getting saved. Here's all my thoughts about evangelism. If we do the first two, evangelism will just take care of itself. People will just get saved, because when you do the first two, it looks a lot like Jesus, and when people actually see Jesus, then he is irresistible, and they will have to receive him. But I'm telling you, the greatest altar call that anybody may ever receive is the one, the invitation that they receive for them to come over to your house. We got to pursue uncommon unity in our homes. We got to take personal responsibility. But in order to do those first two things, then we got to do a little cleaning out of our house, right? You can't just keep adding things to the home without clearing out. So third and finally today, we got to cleanse the home of any and all idols. I just thought we'd end light, you know. Talk about idolatry, personal idolatry in your house. I thought we'd end just a little breath. Anybody else like very particular about the cleanliness of their home, like me? Anybody? Anybody else filled with the Spirit of God and your hand towel has to hang a certain way? Don't dry your hands and then leave it bunched up. What is this, Sodom and Gomorrah? Straighten that thing back out. Gets all smelly and gross and stays wet. How many of you know too, when you actually clean the house, this will be a, hey, maybe a clue for some of you husbands. You don't just vacuum around the stuff. You move the stuff and vacuum under the stuff. I'll just vacuum around the coffee table. No, you move the coffee table and then you vacuum under the coffee table. Because y'all know, like, the dirtiest stuff, the grimy stuff, and the spiders who are of Satan, they linger in dark corners. So you've got to remove the stuff from dark corners and actively sweep the corners so that you can actually clean your house. Do you know that idolatry and idols are very much the same way? They tend to creep in the back door on our best intentions and put their feet up on the coffee table and convince us that they aren't doing any harm when they're actually wrecking the altars that are meant to be given to God and building up altars themselves. We got to move some stuff around and we got to clean the corners when it comes to our idolatry in our homes. So here's what I'm going to present to you. I had a whole thing here where I was going to talk about, hey, maybe this is an idol in your house and maybe this is an idol, but God switched it on me. And today I'm just gonna give us some idol detecting questions for you to take home and to do personal inventory of what idols may be set up in your home. And here's my prayer for these idol detecting questions, that these would be like smoke alarms to our soul the way that they are in our house. Because you know how loud smoke alarms are? Especially when the battery's dying and you're like, for the love, somebody get a battery. I haven't had batteries in 15 years. Where did I put those things? You gotta change the battery and put it back in. But smoke alarms are so loud because they have to awaken sleeping people because they know what's at stake. I'm praying that these idol detecting questions would feel the same to our soul, that they would wake them up and help us to see what's at stake as we clean these idols out of our house. So I've got four questions to detect idols. Number one, and I'm not gonna spend a lot of time on each of these. I'm gonna let them sit and let the Holy Spirit do work with you however he sees fit. Number one, for idol detecting questions, what brings my home the most joy or the most sadness? You know that laughter and tears are actually great God revealers. What do you mourn over? I mean, what breaks your heart? Because let me tell you something, this hit me last week, and I so strongly believe this, that when we begin to mourn over the things that God mourns over, that those tears are the first fruits of revival. God then sees a people he can trust. What brings your home the most joy or the most sadness? Number two, what do I spend most of my time discussing in my home? What you talking about? What y'all spend a lot of time just discussing? You know, worship has a consuming nature about it, and I don't mean just singing. I mean that even in Old Testament sacrifices, when they put their sacrifice on the altar, they had to sit there and watch as it was completely consumed. So let me just tell you, whatever we are facing, whatever we are consuming, whatever we are discussing is revealing to us what ultimately has our hearts. Let me put it this way. Y'all ever been around someone who like just fell in love? Lord help us. It's like they just can't shut up about the other person. It doesn't matter what you bring up. You'd be like, I just bought a new refrigerator the other day. They'd be like, I love to chill with my boo. And I'm like, ain't nobody said nothing about your boo. Why? Because when you are consumed with love, it naturally overflows out of your mouth. So let me just, as humbly but as kindly as I can say it, what do we have trouble shutting up about? It might be showing what has consumed us and what we love. Number three, what has the final say in decisions I make about my home? Somebody has the final word. Something has the final word. Is it the kids' schedule? Is it, hey, let's just put it this way. When it came to overflow offering or just giving in general, what has the final say? Is it what your bank account is saying, or is it truly what the voice of God is saying? Someone has the final say. And then fourth and final, what do other people say my home feels like? What do other people say my home feels like? You know, homes have a feeling. I have a friend, Courtney, she just moved down the street from me. And she said that she invited a friend over not that long ago. And without being asked, this friend walked in the house and said, man, I just felt a peace as soon as I walked in. Why is that? Because I know my friend Courtney, and I know for a fact that she walked around every house in her home and prayed over it that it would be designated to the Lord. You think the Lord's not just going to be drawn to that? It marked her home. Hey, maybe even better question, what would God say your home feels like? I think it would be tied to an aroma, a scent. You know every home has like a smell? You know how grandma's home has a smell? Mimi, if you're watching, beautiful, best smell I've ever smelled. I love it so much. But every home has a smell. My home growing up, my parents, smells awesome because my mom stays on that Bath and Body Works plug-in game. So I walk in, it just feels a certain way because it smells like home. It smells like cinnamon usually, which seems like a mom scent always. I don't know why, but I'm here for the cinnamon. You know, God has a pleasing aroma that he is drawn to. Me and some of my friends just were reading through the Bible in 90 days, and we just finished up Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy. You know what we all commented on? How much everything's on fire. Like, I'm talking turtle doves and oxen and goats and lambs and beans, greens, potatoes, tomatoes, lambs, rams, hogs, dogs. Everything's on fire. God loves a grill. Right? Everything's on fire, but let me ask you this. Again, we gotta stop sanitizing the Bible. Y'all ever been around when like hair's burning? Ugh, is right. So think about this. You have blood, flesh, and hair on fire pretty much all the time. Imagine the smell that filled the entire camp. And humanity would say, oh, that's such a terrible smell. But God goes, that is such a pleasing aroma to me. Why? Because every sacrifice, everything put on the altar was an act of sacrificial obedience. And God can't help but breathe deeply and rush in to those who have placed everything on the altar by sacrificial obedience. So here's my question for us today, church. When it comes to those idol detecting questions, how can we actively stand in the gap? How can we ensure, how can we have a vision for our home that our car's no longer our car, but it's a holy place? And my couch, God sees, is a place where he can bring those who are broken and who are hurting, and they can come and they can find rest. Can he find a kitchen table where he can bring those to come around and pursue a common unity where he knows I will provide a meal in the table of the presence of their enemies, and the enemy will look in and see I can't have access to this home because they've designated it to the Lord. I think we can all agree, NewSpring, that the time of playing polite Christian games is at an end. We can no longer just do the least possible minimum so that we can still call ourselves a Christian. No, that is a complacent and apathetic and religious spirit, and it is begging us to do the least minimum that we can do so that we can still put a tag of Christian on the end of the day, lay our head on a pillow, and go to sleep. And I'm asking us to call, I can't do it anymore. Look, I will go first in this. I cannot rock less boats and continue to lose more souls. I can't do it. It is time for us to step up and see how we can stand in the gap with our homes. Ask God to break our hearts and to give us a vision for how revival, the first matchlight of revival, can start in your house and in mine. So I have a question to end this with today, church. What's revival look like? I don't know. Let's put our homes on the altar and find out. That's how revival starts. So we're going to do that to end today. We're going to ask God to give us a vision, a personal vision for what our home could look like. So I'm going to invite everyone on every campus to just stand to their feet. And I'm just going to say, listen, I know I just ended with my voice high and my emotions high. And I'm telling you, it's because there is a level of desperation that the Holy Spirit feels about this, that we can't waste any more time. Do you wonder why the world is so loud right now, why there seems to be chaos everywhere? I believe it's because the enemy sees that his tactics are finally being exposed. His hatred is being exposed. His racism is being exposed. His disunity is being exposed. His apathy is being exposed. His spirit of religion is being exposed. And Father God is inviting us in right now to not just listen to the chaos of the world, but to join into the kingdom agenda to actively drive it out. That's what we can do. That's what we said yes to. Let's put our homes on the altar and let's find revival there waiting for us. So as we enter into this last song, it's called Welcome in This Place. And let it not just be this place. Let it be every place that we're about to head home to. So I would love to invite you. I wrote this prayer, a blessing over our church, a blessing over you, that before we sing this last song, I would just love to pray over you. So if you're willing to receive this today, can I just invite you to close your eyes and to just put your hands in front of you like this in a posture of receiving? I'm telling you, church, something is sparking. If we will invite the Holy Spirit to breathe on it, let it begin in us. Father God, I pray for an outpouring of your Spirit like never before on my church family. I pray for a hunger for your presence to consume all of our homes, and as it does, may we search and find the pantry of God stored up with the inheritance secured for us by Christ himself. A table prepared in the presence of our enemies. May heaven find a home with us and let it rest as a covering over our doorposts. May every address become an outpost. May unity find a place to reign around our kitchen tables. May the hearts of fathers be turned to their sons and the hearts of sons be turned to their fathers. May daughters find a security of identity as they watch their mothers delight in you. May the presence of darkness find itself even now retreating as heaven invades our houses, making every home become a beacon of light, calling every community to awaken. Holy Spirit, please stand at our doors and knock until we allow you full access. May revival sweep through our nation as it sweeps through our rooms, and may the world look in and see South Carolina ablaze. If we will provide the fire, will you provide the sacrifice? If we will provide the sacrifice, God, will you provide the fire? And above all, may God be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
The King, this is your kingdom. Jesus, come. You're the Father, this is your home. Abba, come. If home is where the heart is, well, and I will open up to you. You're welcome in this place. You're welcome in this place. Come and have your way in us. You're welcome. You're welcome in this place. You're welcome in this place. Come and have your way.
Your way in us. let's take that higher.
Now that you are here, we have everything we need. Now that you are here, now that you are here, we have everything we need. Now that you are here, you welcome in this place. Come and have your way with us. Your way.
What an incredible day that we have had already. I don't know about you, but I have felt so challenged, yes. So inspired, from the whole day, from worship to that incredible message,
right.
That we had from teaching pastor Meredith Knox. I've just been thinking about my own life,
right.
And what does revival look like, and what does the altar of my home represent, and something that I know we've had conversations about,
right.
But I've had conversations with my family of, hey, how can we expect things to look different in the world, in the church,
yes.
If it doesn't first start in our house?
Right.
So I know that I'm leaving particularly challenged about that today.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I know I am, and specifically, I'd love to speak into the beauty, as what you're saying, the responsibility we feel,
yeah.
as children of God to model this. And so for us in our home, one of the simple things is,
yeah.
You know, God says in his word, Jesus teaches us in our prayer, on earth as it is in heaven.
Yeah.
Revelation 7:9 teaches us what that looks like.
Mm-hmm.
And so just personally in our home, my wife and I, we're in an interracial marriage.
Yeah.
But one of the things that we want to model for our kids is to reflect what God's kingdom looks like. Because
yeah.
This is God's heart. This is the Father's heart.
Yeah.
And so we want to welcome that into our home, just like we want to welcome it into this home, the church.
Yeah. Yeah.
So yeah, how about you? What is
yes.
something that you and
well,
your family are?
Well, I just want to say thank you so much. I feel
yeah.
like I have learned so much, especially in light of us honoring MLK Day that
mm-hmm.
is coming up this week.
Yeah.
I know Brad mentioned it earlier, but for me, I feel like I have really wanted to learn and understand the significance
mm-hmm.
Of this. So we actually have some resources that
right.
we would love for you to be able to get. Maybe you missed it earlier in the gathering, but if you text MLK to 30303, we've collated some resources that have just helped us learn and understand. So I just want to thank you for that, because I feel
yeah.
like I've been able to learn so
right,
much
right.
of, yeah, how do we make a difference of you know, understanding
mm-hmm.
racial reconciliation in our own homes first,
right, right.
to be able to see, yeah,
right.
a real move. And that's what we're praying, we're believing for.
Yep.
So yeah, I'm excited.
Absolutely. And I also want to say thank you for being willing to want to learn, because it means a lot to someone like me to have a sister in Christ who is willing to want to understand
yeah.
and take it seriously to where you want to do the same in your home.
Yeah.
So I just want to say thank you.
Exactly.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Well, I'm so thankful for this series. I feel like we're getting to learn, to understand, to really assess so much of the altars in our own life and revival, because that's what we're praying and that's
Absolutely.
What we're believing for.
Yes.
So I hope that you can join us next week as we talk about week 3 of this series, Altars, and what it looks like. Thank you.
Thank you.